this chair. Put stuff in there. Why don't they want to feel like bigger, taller people? Why would you not want? Why would you want to? I don't know what the word is that I'm looking for.
Juxtapose? Is that it?
I don't know
if that's it.
All right.
Live podcast. Podcast going live. Should probably looked all this stuff up beforehand. Good morning, Josh.
Good morning. You worked out today, too.
I worked out.
I think this is the first time we've ever done this where we've both worked out prior to the pod.
That means my CNS is fired up.
I see what you did there.
Yeah. It's a good one today for those that are watching live or those that will listen to this after the fact and you're like, yeah, it was a good workout. It was a good workout. We did some.
Oh, I thought you were referring to the podcast. It's going to be a good one. But
both.
Okay.
This is going to be a good one as well because we got a lot of questions. We got power cleans, burpee bar. We had the box jump overs and power cleans in the workout today, building off of what we did last week if you were here. If not, hey, still get a good workout.
Oh, I'm over here. All right, now I can rock. Now I feel good.
So I just locked mine because
I don't like to do that.
It that just made me nauseous. But in the middle, like when we're talking, I'll want
That's
to.
That's right, you get car sick, don't you?
Dude.
I remember when we drove to Miami, That was a big concern of mine that you were going to vomit in my car.
It was bad. Like, I love my mom, right? But sometimes
I love your mom too.
She'll break too much. And I'm like,
is that a generalization about female drivers that you just made there?
Are you going to cancel me? No.
So, funny story about people that don't ride well in cars. You know, Mandy just got a new car. And Jesse has a friend who doesn't do well in car rides for a while. And Mandy recently had to escort this child from one place to another. And she said in the back of her mind, she's like, I really hope this kid doesn't just puke all in my new car. And, of course, I was thinking the same thing.
Did he?
No.
Oh, that's good.
But I said, never take him anywhere. No, I didn't say that. I'm just kidding.
Leave him at home.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's all the vomit talk I think that we're going to get on today, although we are talking about the nervous system, so maybe it'll come up.
Yeah, maybe. How do you do... You said that's all the vomit talk. How do you do with blood and, like, broken bones and stuff?
I think that is the coolest thing ever.
Did you see that guy snap his leg in the UFC fight? Did you see the video?
I did not, no.
If you guys are either in the UFC, which I'm not, but you're into the cool videos, which I am, you have to... check that video out, because if you can handle, like, broken bones and, like, not safe for work type stuff.
The only things that give me the little bit of queasies is, and don't Google this, kids, so let me put this disclaimer out there, is crush injuries.
When people get crushed?
No, like, what is that? So, like, if you look up what rhabdo injuries can look like from a musculoskeletal standpoint. Now you're gonna Google it, aren't you?
Yeah, keep going.
But yeah, there are some really vivid graphic images of basically it looks like tissue is getting ready to explode from a body cavity. Whoa. Those are the ones that are like, all right, that's borderline like a little bit too much for me. So that's actually a super common cause of rhabdo.
It's like
a crush injury. I don't want to look at it. I can neither confirm nor deny what you were looking at. But I'll find a picture later, and I'll send it to you. So, while you're looking for that, I'll detail the upcoming events. So next Saturday, not the next Saturday, that would be this Saturday.
Yes.
But the following Saturday, May the 8th, from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m., is the Clean and Jerk Clinic with Coach Gene.
Mm-hmm.
Again, from 11 to 1, so if you say, man, I would love to do some more sport of weightlifting things in a controlled environment where that's what you're doing the whole time, working for 2 hours, drilling things, getting good coaching. Come spend 2 hours with Gene next Saturday, May 8th.
Yeah, only heard good stuff about those clinics. Not that, I don't know.
We don't ever broadcast the bad stuff. Yes. We just delete those Google reviews.
Yeah, but genuinely have only heard good things about them, and I've seen a couple of them like in the beginnings, because then I'll end up leaving. And they're awesome. So, Queen's Air Clinic, Saturday, May 8th.
And then after that, we've got at the end of May, I can't believe we're at the end of April already, first 4 months of this year gone. But at the end of May, basically a month from now, you've got Memorial Day. So that's Saturday, May 29th. This is our Memorial Day workout. Coincidentally, this was unplanned. I'm wearing the shirt from the 2 years ago when we did it.
Yes.
So that is the workout that was created by Coach Mark James and then other Mark, Jay. Those guys had a hand in creating our own little Memorial Day workout. So that is going to be Saturday, May 29th. And then that following Monday, which is actual Memorial Day, we will be closed. So come get your workout in that Saturday and enjoy the remainder of the holiday weekend with your family and friends.
Yes.
Get some vitamin D. And that's it. I'll see you guys next week.
That's it. That's where I should start loading in the outro music right there.
It's just right there.
We're done. Start playing the outro. No, but we have quite a few listener questions today. We'll see if we can get to all of them, because we have the ones that are right here on our page. There was one that was asked to us through Facebook when I posted that we were going to be answering these ones. And then there was one posted to our staff Slack page, which is just how we... For those that don't know, that's how we communicate to each other. Amongst the staff. So, lots of questions. I don't know if we'll get to all of them, but I know that today we are talking about the CNS. CNS, it's something that we say a lot. I think it's something that a lot of people in the fitness space throw around a lot to either drive home a point or attempt to look smart when it comes to talking about it. CNS stands for central nervous system. What's it do? What's it do in reference to exercise? And how long does it take for your CNS to recharge after a max effort bout of exercise? So we'll answer all those questions. And then if there's time, which there might or might not be, we will get to the other questions. So Josh, what is the CNS?
Well, you stole part of it. And that you define the acronym. So CNS is an acronym that is short for Central Nervous System. And just as a disclaimer, if you are a nerd or somebody who loves to learn a lot, you're going to love this podcast.
Oh.
If you're not, then you probably won't.
Go listen to another one.
Full disclosure. Yeah, go listen to one of our other episodes. Where we talk about shoes, maybe something like that.
Yeah.
Anyway, so CNS is the Central Nervous System. It is one part of our whole nervous system. So there are two components to the nervous system. There's the CNS, and then there is the PNS. And we'll talk just briefly about that. But the central nervous system is the structure of the brain and the spinal cord. The PNS is the peripheral nervous system. So if you imagine, I'm sure everybody has an image of what the brain and especially the spinal cord are. Now, the peripheral nervous system is all the nerves and everything that innervate your muscles and tissues and all that kind of stuff off of the spinal cord. That's kind of the way to think about it. But the central nervous system is really the governor of your body. It's the brain. It's what tells all of the functions of your body what they should be doing. It takes in stimuli from other aspects of the PNS. Figures out what is going on, how do we need to respond, how do we regulate hormone production, how do we regulate skin secretions, pupil dilation, all of these things are basically controlled. It is the brain system or the supercomputer of the body, I guess is the fun way to put it.
Yeah, it's a good way to put it.
Yeah.
So that's what the CNS is. That's kind of what it does.
Yeah.
Why is that important for us?
So one of the key reasons why we talk about the CNS in regards to exercise is because the first thing that you have to recognize is any sort of physical challenge that you endure is a stress. And so when you stress the body, it is basically putting stress onto the central nervous system. So as fitness coaches, what we're thinking about when we say, you know, this is going to depress your central nervous system, or this is going to affect it in such a way that you don't want to, what we're saying is that there is going to be an impact on this, and it's just something that we need to be aware of. That's one of the key things that we're talking about all the time. Now, back of the house, back room, what in particular you concern yourself with is regards to program design. So when you are working with an individual or a group, you have to make considerations for the actual way that the body develops from a CNS standpoint. I'll give you a really simple illustration. So everyone knows that I love cars. If you were to take your favorite car in the world and then take out the engine that it has in it and put one in that is 4 times as powerful, the thinking is that, because I've seen my son and my daughter do this, it's like, well, we just add more power, more strength, and the car is going to go that much faster. But the reality is, if you have even half of a brain, part of your CNS, no pun intended, what you recognize is that you are actually just going to destroy the actual automobile. And so if you go about, this is why I was relating it to you, if you go about program design in such a way that does not respect that, i.e., if you put a bunch of maximal level contractions, stuff that is asking people to dig really deep into their central nervous system, they're just going to crash and burn, or even worse, they are going to get hurt and injured. So putting that engine that is way too big into a car that just can't handle it is the same thing as programming that doesn't take into account how the body actually develops properly.
Okay.
So that's kind of the surface level, elementary, you know, type thing for people to keep in mind.
Yeah, so pretty much the CNS is responsible for when it's fully charged. It almost can be looked at, and this might be wrong, it sounds kind of wrong, but it's almost like an intensity regulator, but you don't have any say in the intensity that you're putting forth. It's all up to the CNS.
Right.
Meaning that if it's fully charged, awesome. Like, you're going to be able to push harder versus, like you said, if it's very depressed, not like mopey and sad, but
right,
if it's just not working at full function, you're not going to be able to tap into the well, as you said, as often.
Right.
Okay, cool. The well referring to high intensity exercise.
Yes.
So I'm sure we're going to circle back and answer a lot of these too, but we're just kind of powering through to the next one, and then we'll bring it all together. Is if you do have one of those max effort bouts of exercise, or something that's really high intensity,
yeah.
For the purpose of our listeners, think like an open workout type thing,
yeah,
right? Or any sort of like max effort mile run or something like that. How long does it take for your CNS to recharge, get out of that depressed state, and get back to near or at full capacity?
Well, it takes a lot longer than what the vast majority of people think that it takes them. Because a lot of times we try to go off of how does my body feel? And while I'm sympathetic to people owning their body and owning the notion that, well, I know my body better than anybody. Yes, that is true, but it doesn't mean that you actually know and have good awareness to what is going on. And I can say this with good confidence because I've seen what people do day in and day out with regards to a movement practice, day in and day out after they have had bouts of high intensity work, coming in and saying, yeah, I feel great, I'm gonna crush it, and then they get absolutely crushed into the ground even further. And a lot of the conversation afterwards is, I don't know what happened. And it's, well, what happened is that your central nervous system, your CNS, was just simply not recovered. So The further developed that you are in the exercise game, so we use a term called training age, but the more formal that your training age is, the more advanced you are, the deeper that you can go into the well, so to speak. Meaning, the more that you can ask your central nervous system to actually put out. And so it's kind of, you'll have to correct me from a mathematical term maybe, but I don't know if it's a inverted relationship or one that rides right along. But basically, the more developed that your CNS is, the deeper that you can go, and the longer it's going to take it to recover.
Yeah, I think
because of that.
Inverse relationship.
Right? So if you don't have a well-developed CNS, well, you can't actually get into high-intense, maximal contraction type efforts. And so because of that, you can actually recover quite quickly. I want to pause and give you opportunity to respond, but thoughts, concerns, questions?
No, I mean, it makes sense because a note I was just typing out that plays off of that is, so you said the deeper that you dig into the well, or the harder that you push yourself, the longer it's going to take that CNS to recharge. And so something we've kind of been preaching to people, we've said it on here, we've said it in class, we've said it in conversation, put it on social media, is that we want to talk about fitness and exercising serving you, not burning you. And this is kind of our scientific way of saying that, right? Referring to the CNS. So again, we've said this 1,000 times, so we're probably going to sound like a broken record, but if you're coming in and you work out at 5:30 or 9 a.m. or even as late as like 7 p.m., right? And you went as hard as you possibly could, and to the point where you are just totally fried the rest of the day, or you have a tough time getting up the next day and going about your normal daily functions, you dug too deep, right?
Yes.
You've gotten to the point to where your central that's your central nervous system, right? You've dug deep. You got a good workout, which go back to our listen to our podcast about what a good workout is. You got a good workout, but at what cost, right? So you weren't able to function, right? You weren't able to work out at the same intensity, at a consistent intensity the next day. And by intensity, I don't mean it has to be intense. Like, we have low intensity exercise, we have moderate intensity. It's a spectrum, right?
Right.
So that's just kind of playing off of the point you made, where the deeper you dig, the more of a deficit you're going to be at. And the more the deficit you're going to be at, the longer it's going to take to recharge and reach that full max, true max effort again.
Yep. And go ahead, you're about to.
No, I was going to say, I was actually talking to Jay this week, and we weren't talking specifically about the CNS, but his came up, and a good example is, you know, he made it to the peak of his sport, right? So the games, the CrossFit games. And his games, the Masters games, usually end on like a Friday. And I think he said his ended on a Friday. And, you know, he hung out for a day or two. Him and his family enjoyed Carson or Madison or wherever they were in the country. Then there was a day or two of travel time. However it worked out, he rested on Monday and he came back into the gym on Tuesday. And he said that he would come in, you as the coach said, I'm not giving you anything, come in and do something you like to do. He came in, he likes to do snatches. He knew when he first started warming up, he was like, today is not the day.
Yeah.
And he felt fried. And this is Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, you know, 96 hours after he finished a competition, 4 whole days, and he was still fried, right? There's a lot that goes into that. It's very stressful. It's the peak of his sport. Everything was leading up to that moment. There was travel time, but it just shows you that if you're somebody and you want to go at the same max effort every single day, one, like you said, I don't want to be rude, but I don't care how well you know your body, physiologically, you can't.
Right.
And you're not gonna if you want to come in and go as hard on Tuesday as you did on Monday.
Yes.
You want to say something earlier?
Now, what is interesting about the sport side of CrossFit that it has kind of, to the casual observer, from the outside looking in, it seems like, well, these guys and girls at the top are just going hard all day, every day, and they're doing high intense work, and that is what I need to be doing. And that is actually not what is happening on a day-to-day basis. The vast majority of the stuff they're doing is going to be low-level aerobic, you know, based work. And that is why they're actually able to recover, because they do not spend every session, very few sessions, going to the well in their training. Now, when they go to the games, it's not just about the physical piece, because they have done harder workouts, more reps in training, more volume, more intensity, so on and so forth, but it's all the ancillary things that being on the biggest stage does to you. Not sleeping in your same bed, not being in the same environment, you know, plane rides, different kinds of foods. And do they try to control this to the best of their ability? Yes. But the reality is, they walk away from these competitions very, very depleted too, which is the example you just gave from Jay. But on the day-to-day basis, the reason that they are able to continue to train consistently is because their training does not actually look like just the highlights that you're seeing on the gram, right? They may have a 6-hour training session, so show you one little piece, and people are like, oh man, that looks great, I'm gonna try that workout. Well, for that person, that was actually an aerobic effort. For you, it may be a highly unsustainable effort to even get close to something like that.
Yeah. It's easy to get caught up in the if-then-why-not-me mentality of that whole sport and really exercise in general, because you're not, and I'm not trying to be a jerk, because I do the same exact thing, that like, we're not at their level, right? Mm-hmm. We're not going to just be able to go run 6,000 meters or whatever and feel fine the next day.
Right.
Like arguably there's no reason to be doing that, which is what, that's almost 4 miles. Like, if I ran more than 2 miles right now, if I ran more than a mile and a half right now, I'd be so sore, right? So those are the things to consider. That's also what a coach is for.
Right.
Not to plug that, you know, yeah, more than we have, but I mean, that's what we're for, is to tell you guys that, and not bring you back down to earth, but tell you these things so that you can approach training appropriately for you, whether you do want to do the high intensity things that we said you need to earn, or you just want to be overall healthier.
Right.
Right. Go ahead.
So I was going to ask you, you know, in terms of when you look at it from a programming standpoint, what are the things that you're thinking of from a CNS standpoint, you know, and I don't want to lead you down any specific path, but is it, you look at, oh, well, we did this series of movements today, and so we need to be careful not to do a series of movements and it's going to compound the effect. Is it sets? Is it reps? Is it, you know, just what are the thoughts that go through your head as a coach when you're looking at things like that?
I like that question. I'm making for our chapter markers. Yeah, that's a good question. So, as we said, fitness should serve you, not burn you, and arguably, unless you are interested in taking it to the next level in terms of competition, there is never any reason to dig so deep that you can't come back the next day or even later that day and give the same effort.
Yeah.
So a good example is of today. So some would look at the workout we did today. It was a 10-minute EMOM. On the odd minutes, you do 30 seconds of box jump overs. On the even minutes, you do 30 seconds of power cleans. Some would look at that, and maybe your coach tells you, go as hard as you possibly can, 30 seconds. And you know that's going to be a pretty tough workout. Or your coach tells you, maintain consistency or do better across each round, which is what we tell our people. I have no doubt that the way we did that workout today, and if it's executed properly, you could be able to come back, take the 5 or 7 p.m. class. Don't do it, but you could come do it and do the same.
Right.
And you could do exactly the same. That's what I think about when I'm writing workouts. Is this going to completely crush people? Which, admittedly, like that used to be the idea. Is it's like, okay, what's something that's going to be tough?
Mm-hmm.
Right? And that was a fault of mine. Is what's something that's going to be really tough that's just going to crush people, because that's something that a lot of people crave for so long, right? And whether we realize it or not. And so, how can I give them that dose? Now it's more along the lines of, okay, could we come back and repeat this workout? Are the 7 reps enough to create a little bit of soreness, but not so much that you can't come back the next day, like you were talking about in your blog, right? Because you wrote a really good blog about that.
Yes.
Good plug. Those are really the things I'm thinking about. So in terms of weightlifting, is it something that you could come back and repeat the next day? The Metcon, is it something that you could come back and repeat the next day, or improve on the next week if you had to, which is the goal with these progressions that we're doing. So.
Yeah, and I think a lot about just and this is kind of, again, this is the art of coaching, but like there is also a science to it as well. And when you understand the science of motor learning, as in the way that you learn to do a given skill or a task. Nobody goes out and looks for the most complex task and tries to do that thing. You know, step outside of your given sphere or your level of expertise and go to a completely different field and look for the most complex looking thing that you can. You're not going to ask to do that thing, unless you're an idiot. And if you do ask, somebody that is competent is going to say, oh, if you want to do this, let me show you the first thing, the most basic thing that you need to learn how to do. And so this is like level 1 neural adaptation, is the bicep does this movement, right? So like a bicep curl. So that is what we call learning motor control, which is basically just like the fancy way of saying this, hey muscle, this is what your function is, and this is how you should be operating. You got to get really, really good at doing that. You don't go from really never doing a squat to doing a heavy squat, a heavy loaded squat in a really fatigue-based setting. You may think that that's the thing that you need to do, and you may actually do it, but you're certainly not going to recover and adapt or grow from it. You're just going to develop compensatory patterns to survive through the movement. And that's not the goal of what you're coming in here for. The goal is for what you're doing in here to actually serve your life outside of the gym so that you can thrive. So if we go back to, okay, so what are the progressions that we should be doing? It's learn how to do the very, very basic thing and control it through I'm just gonna call it a good range of motion. And I don't want to say the right range of motion, because that is very different for every single person, right? If you've been sedentary and sitting for 8 hours a day for 10 years of your life, we might say, I would love to see you squat down below parallel and stand back up. But if that's the standard that I hold you to from day one, you're going to feel like a failure right out of the gate. So it's, what is the range of motion that we can get you to express with control? And then you go from there. Then it's like, okay, you did it one time. Can you do it 2 times? And then we continue to add volume. So we would just call that muscle endurance. We're trying to just stay under the fatigue before we've actually learned to load anything with weight or resistance or things like that.
Yeah.
So that's just the very basics of learning movement.
It's funny, so Bart was in class today. Actually, we were all in class today, and Bart was doing something a little bit different, because Bart sat down with you and talked about goals, and you guys came up with a plan, and something I was talking to him about, and something you and I talked about last week was, or the week before, was a
lot of people recognize the names, of course, Matt Fraser, but also Josh Bridges in terms of, like, the fitness space. And Josh Bridges, he has a podcast, and he got on the podcast, and he was asked, he said, what are some movements, and him and Matt Fraser were asked this, what are some movements that, now that you're not competing anymore, what do you not do? And Josh couldn't answer the question quick enough. He was like,
yes,
pistols, 100%. So I pistols because, I mean, pistols really flashy movement, but if you don't need to do it, meaning if you're not training to compete, so that's 99.99999% of people,
There
is absolutely no reason for you to be doing a pistol. And if you're looking for the same stimulus that a pistol provides, he's like, do a lunge pattern, do a step up, do a split squat, like do some other single leg movement. He also said handstand push-ups. He's like, I never do handstand push-ups. He's like, maybe once in a blue moon, I'll do strict. But he doesn't even kip them. He's like, I don't do kipping. He's like, just do a push press.
Right.
He's like, do a dumbbell. He actually said, because we did this in our first block, he's like, do a seated dumbbell press. He's like, if you want to do strict push-up, handstand push-ups or kipping handstand push-ups, he's like, do a strict or seated dumbbell press. Do a push dumbbell push press. Do a barbell push press. Matt Fraser's answer was really interesting because I know we have a lot of people that love weightlifting and they love weightlifting heavy, myself included. I love doing it.
Mm-hmm.
But he's like, I get people asking me all the time, they're like, what's your one rep max clean and jerk? Or when was the last time you tested that? He's like, I don't know, like 2015, 2016. And then, you know, all those guys are pretty vulgar. I don't know if you listen to some clips.
I've heard some of them, yeah.
But he's like, why would I ever test my one rep max clean and jerk in training? He's like, that is the stupidest explicative idea I've ever, you know? And so it was like, you know, it's shocking to hear that from people that were at the pinnacle, right?
Right.
But at the same time, it's reassuring because you're like, oh, you're like, I know what we're doing is making me better. I feel it, right? And we don't need to weightlift like that anymore. Does that mean we never will again? Who knows? Does it mean I don't like doing it? Absolutely not. I love lifting heavy. But it just goes to show that these guys aren't doing stuff like that all the time, right?
Yeah, one of the things that I think about all the time is this phrase that I heard, I think it was earlier this year, is just because it exists doesn't mean you should be doing it.
Yeah.
And you could say that of a pistol, you could say that of a snatch, a clean and jerk, you could say that of a kipping pull-up, you could say that about a handstand push-up. I mean, there's an infinite amount of examples, and we're not picking on it just because, you know, I just don't think that you should be doing it. No, there's actual reason why. And I did overhear a little bit of the conversation you were having this morning, and in my head I'm thinking, you know, well, if I'm somebody that's listening to this, I'm like, yeah, you know what, I might not need to do it, but I want to do it. Great. So, and I know we weren't intending to go down this direction, but I did just want to share this. So here's the thing. If you want to do it, great. Then you need to follow a progression to do it and recognize that if you sit in a chair for 8+ hours a day, like probably everybody that's listening to this, especially if you are listening to this as you drive to the office or drive home from the office after just sitting all day, it is going to take you a really, really long time to be able to express that movement. We're just talking specifically about a pistol.
Yeah.
And that is just pure biomechanics, you know, and exercise physiology. I could force you into that position and potentially have your hip, knee, and ankle explode, but that's not going to do anybody any good. Because presumably, if you do it once, you're going to want to do it again, and again, and again, and again, which means you need to be able to express it good one time such that you can recover, adapt, and grow and be able to do it the next day and the following day and the following day. So if you can't do that, if you have not been doing something that is similarly close, it's really a poor expectation to put upon yourself that, oh, I'm just going to try these cool, quick little things that I saw on Instagram or I heard this other person talking about, And lo and behold, you get it because you duct tape yourself with all kinds of things to help you get into that position, because you're not actually going to keep that.
Right.
It's the same thing as doing a 30-day cleanse or some sort of challenge where you lose your weight, and then guess what? When you stop doing the thing, you're going to gain it all plus more back. Well, in the case of the pistol, what you're probably going to gain back is your inability to squat as deep as you were with two legs before, and you're probably going to inherit some sort of pathological issue or injury or chronic pain. So, and I'm not trying to do that as like some fear mongering, because I know that's so popular these days, but this is just the reality. I'm not saying you can't learn to do it. I can teach you how to do it, but I need you to have some patience and understand that it is going to take a really, 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 really long time. And here's the other thing. Why it's going to take even longer than people expect is because if that thing is not actually in service of the true reason why you are training, then you're not going to go into it. We talked about this last week. You're not going to go into each session that you do that thing with the right intention.
Yeah.
I don't know where that came from the stuff that we were just talking about, but...
No, it's good. I was actually thinking that same thought, but you tie it all back together is, you know, being able to recharge and come back and do it again the next day. And like you said, we don't want to drive fear in any of you guys or tick any of you guys off that like weightlifting or want to do pistols, right? If you do 50 or 60 pistols in a workout today, are you going to be out of commission tomorrow? Who knows?
Probably.
If
you didn't do 50 or 60 yesterday.
If you didn't do 50 or 60 yesterday, right? If you clean and jerk one rep max today, are you going to be out of commission tomorrow? Probably, right? A week from now, will you be fine? Who knows, right? We're not trying to scare anybody, right? You're not going to totally tank everything that you've done in one session, caveat, if you are ready for it.
Right.
If you weren't ready for it, you're running a big risk. That's just what we're trying to get across. And bringing it all back to the central nervous system and kind of how long does it take to recharge and all of that, just keep all of that in mind, right? So it's not like you can't come in one day and do a max and then come in the next day and do a max in the next day, because repeated across a week, a month, a year, 5 years, it's going to add up. And you're going to be in a place that you don't want to be in, where you're injured for 9 or 10 months out of the year.
Yeah.
Not being able to do the things you like because you wanted to do it once.
Right. Yes.
Stephanie said something funny. Stephanie said, stop talking about the things I like, says the person who hasn't been able to lift heavy or do pistols in over a year. Right? So.
It's tough. It is very tough mentally. And I recognize when we say things like this, it's very hard to wrap your head around, wait a minute, so I shouldn't chase, not that you shouldn't chase that thing, but you probably shouldn't be attempting that thing today. I'm not trying to put a cap on anybody's potential. In fact, what I'm most excited when I work with people is in getting them to understand that they have more potential than they think. But I'm referring specifically to their potential relative to them, not relative to what they've seen somebody else on the gram do.
The gram.
It's just, let's focus on you, not what you see others doing. You know, if you never saw somebody do a pistol or a handstand push-up or a muscle-up, you would never ask to do that because you wouldn't have it. So just because you saw it and it exists, it's like, oh, I want to be able to do that. No, like, what do you actually want? Now, if you've seen it and it's something you want to work towards, great. There is a way to do it, but it's just going to take time. But anything worth doing takes a long time and it's hard work.
Yeah. I've heard that it takes about 72 hours for your CNS to recharge after a pretty intense bout. So say you did a really tough or high-intensity workout on Monday, and you were to come back on Thursday is when you would start to feel relatively normal again. Is there truth to that?
Yeah, so it depends on again, what the, we talked about this last time, but like what the intention was, what the modality was, what the dose, or excuse me, what the, what was going on with the person. It's easy to say 72 hours, but if in the midst of that 72 hours, you didn't sleep, your nutrition was garbage, you got, you know, into a fight with your spouse, it might be 96 hours, it might be 120, like,
yeah.
So there is all that. Now, let's just say that all things remain equal, you did something tough on Monday, yeah, you should be relatively recovered well enough to come back in and do that same thing again about 72 hours later.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. I'm glad there's truth to that, because that's what I've been saying to people when they ask.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. But it begs the question, if I want to come in and train every day, what should I be doing? I want to be able to do stuff that I can, that is sustainable day after day after day.
Yeah.
Right? So the way that I think about it is, I don't want to learn how to do unsustainable work. That's not what I'm training for. I want to learn to be sustainable so that I can maintain it for a lifetime.
Yeah. You know, talking about all this, and I'm glad Stephanie's in the chat, and Stephanie, I'm talking to you now, so if you'd like to answer this question, I'd love that. But, you know, I think about how, and I think it was in 2017, Stephanie was playing football,
mm-hmm.
right? So she was super active there. She was taking hits. She was giving hits, right? Then she would come in and she would weightlift, but she would also do the open, right? So it's almost like this CNS overload.
Right.
And, I mean, I think I remember how she felt. But Stephanie, if you wanted to throw a comment in there about how you felt during all of that activity, and because I mean it's not like, oh, you know, I just go play a football game and then I feel good and then go weightlift. It's like there are all these things, high movements that require a ton of demand from the CNS, like taking a hit, doing a snatch and a clean and jerk, right, at
mm-hmm.
80 to 90% of your max effort, doing a high intensity CrossFit workout, right? I mean the list goes on, and she says, I peaked, but then I broke, right? So I bet that peak was real brief as well.
Right.
I mean, it was, hey, I peak, I know this is right here, and then she says that she broke, right? So there is a limit that your body can take before, you know, you start feeling and seeing the repercussions of going hard all the time.
Yeah.
And I want to go hard. I want to feel like this all the time.
So,
broke.
I want to read something that I screenshotted and sent to myself that I think is relevant here. So, it's talking about neural adaptations, and this is specifically within aerobic work, but there's a bigger story I'm sure you'll see when I read it. But nervous system adaptations play a significant role in the early stages of aerobic endurance training. So, basically, what this is saying is that what is happening whenever you first learn to move is the motor control piece that I talked about. So in the beginning, efficiency is increased and fatigue at the contractile mechanisms is delayed. Basically, you learn, if you put in the time to move well, then your body figures out, okay, if I can move efficiently like this, I figure out that I don't get fatigued, or I delay the onset of fatigue. So there's that. Additionally, improved aerobic performance is going to result in a rotation of neural activity among synergists and among motor units within a muscle. What does all that fancy terminology mean? It just means that the neural activity that is going on is not going to be just in one specific spot. It's going to innervate all kinds of things around it. So all the helping muscles that are involved in the bicep curl, that are involved in moving things correctly so that you don't just overstress one area and suffer some sort of forearm injury. Maybe some people can identify with that. Okay, so let's learn how to do that. So basically, you're going to produce more efficient locomotion or movement during the activity with lower energy expenditure. So, learn how to do movement at a basically zero fatigue level, And then as you build over time, you can then do more work with less fatigue. And what does that ultimately mean? Is that when you move really, really well, whether you have fatigue or not, your likelihood of getting injured or suffering some sort of chronic overuse thing is going to be diminished. So put in the time to work on motor control, learn how to move correctly with control, and you're going to be in pretty good shape.
And who knows how to program for that?
We do.
Shocker. So this actually segues right into a question we got this morning. I just thought we'd throw in there, talking about burnout and overtraining, because it's kind of, we're kind of talking about the same things as we are with the CNS. So the question is, what's the difference between overreaching and overtraining? How do you know that you're overtraining or burnt out, which is the same thing? Like, what are some symptoms? How do you recover from them and prevent them in the future? Which we kind of just talked about is, you know, don't go so hard all the time. And those are kind of the questions. So overreaching and overtraining.
So what, give me the question again.
What's the difference between overreaching and overtraining?
So overtraining is where you have surpass your body's ability to adapt, recover, and grow, essentially. Instead of maybe taking a half a step back, you're going to take about 12 steps back.
So you get injured?
Potentially. It's not necessarily expressed in injury. That can play a part.
Mm-hmm.
But you're going to, when you know that you are stepping into overtraining when all of the normal functions that you are used to within your body start to be off. So digestion is off, sleep is off, your mental sharpness is off, you're gonna have more aches and pains, inflammation, things like that. Basically, your body is just going into overdrive with trying to get you back to homeostasis. So it's going to depress a lot of the, I know this is going to sound weird, but a lot of the things that aren't super important to the survival of your body in that instant are going to kind of get put on the back burner.
Okay.
So now, stay in overtraining too long, like so you just, you know, end up getting really depressed. And again, we don't mean like we're sad or anything like that. But I just mean that, you know, your nervous system, you know, becomes super depressed. You're going to end up doing some long-term damage. Injury, you could just have decreased cognitive function long-term. And again, these are things that in the moment you don't really know about. But down the road is when you actually really pay the price.
Yeah.
Right? You know, a concussion is a really good one. It's like you kind of get your bell rung, things are a little spacey. 2 or 3 days later, maybe depending upon the severity, you kind of feel back to normal, but down the road you're paying a price.
Okay.
Right? Now, when you are young and super resilient, you can burn the candle at both ends like when Steph was. And I'm not saying that like we're old or anything, but you're just more resilient and you're really using up all the resources that your body has to be able to do all the things. You're going to get super strong, feel very fast. You're not going to need a ton of sleep to just continue to burn really, really hot. But eventually that light bulb is going to burn out and you're going to break. And then when you break once, it's going to be even with more frequency that you are going to break if you try to still do a lot of things that are similar to what you were doing before.
Okay.
So this is why it's really hard for people that were athletes for a number of years to hang that up, put that mantle away, and just recognize that I'm just a human like everybody else. And those are two separate classifications, which I know we've talked about.
So what's overreaching?
So overreaching is where you are stepping just beyond, and I mean like just beyond your current capabilities, such that you can do the work, be slightly challenged, recover, adapt, and grow, and come back tomorrow and repeat.
So essentially, overreaching is much more, in a micro sense, it's what you're doing every day, right? Yeah. You almost want to look to overreach.
Yes.
But, because again, that's, like you said, how you adapt, how you get better. Overtraining, that's in a macro sense.
Yeah.
Okay, things have been going, things have been going wrong, but that's not the right term I like to use. Things have just been off. Okay, you're not moving as well, you're not feeling as well, and then, like you said, you don't really realize it until down the road, unless you have a ton of experience and you know you can pinpoint when and where you are overtraining or when you're gonna overtrain. That's when you can kind of almost feel like you got a crystal ball.
Yeah.
Is when you can kind of judge when it's gonna happen.
Yeah, so there's some really interesting anecdotal stories in the weightlifting world specifically, and there's a great book that I have by a weightlifting coach. His name is Bob Takano. He's on the West Coast. He wrote this book called, it's literally just called Weightlifting Programming. And it's not a super thick book. It's very technical from a numbers perspective, but he gives some really cool stories about, you know, in the early days, the way that they used to know that they were just stepping into the overtraining territory with their athletes is that their bowel movements would be really jacked up, and then they would basically not be getting any sleep at night. So like their sleep would be really, really disrupted. And those were two ways where they knew, oh man, okay, we gotta put the brakes on, scale volume and intensity way back. And so over time, what they did is they allowed those physiological happenings to inform and influence the programming that they were doing. So they could then take their athlete and figure, okay, if we know that we want them to be in we want to overreach, not step into overtraining, they would basically template it out to where if they were going to enter that quote-unquote overtrained state, it would come after a competition because the peaking phase would happen before that overtraining phase. And then they would just kind of back things up from there and say, okay, this is when we need to start this type and cycle of training.
Wow.
Yeah.
I know that's what you do with Jay, right? So after working with him for years, you found that after so many weeks,
yep,
he starts to kind of exhibit many symptoms of overtraining. So you've just kind of made that his little, people are going to roll their eyes when I say this, but his blocks of training, right?
Yeah,
his,
yeah, that's exactly cycles. It, yeah. And so one of the really interesting ones that we found out years ago with Jay is, and I didn't know he was doing this until he told me, but on Sunday mornings, he'd be at church, and he would kind of take his heart rate as he was sitting in the pews, and he would just kind of make little mental notes, and I'm sure he wrote it down too, but there would be weeks that we figured out was usually in the fourth week of training where his heart rate, and that, I don't want to use the term resting heart rate because that's a little bit different, but that's kind of what we referred to it as, but basically his heart rate, you know, when he was just seated, would be elevated by 8 or 10 beats, you know, on this Sunday. And
wow.
And then before we really kind of put all the pieces together, we recognized that, like, okay, if we just kept training that next week, everything was really just depressed from an expectation. Like, man, you should have been able to do this, but you weren't. And then when we did go back and look, we're like, oh, man. So now it's, okay, we go 3 weeks. And if we went that extra week is when we would notice things elevate, but now we go basically 3 weeks, take a easier week from an intensity standpoint, volume still stays up because he reacts and responds really well to volume, but he's also got, you know, a 40-something year history of training,
yeah,
right? So he needs the volume to maintain, like, his base level. But we have been able to continue to progress him just from that one little noticing.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That's really cool. So, overreaching, overtraining, covered the differences there. Symptoms, Josh, you mentioned bowel issues, sleep issues, an elevated resting heart rate or overall heart rate. I know Jay said before that he knows that what kind of day it's going to be because he's come in and his heart rate has gotten over 100, like doing jumping jacks.
Right.
Right. So he's like, oh man, it's going to be like one of those days. And so things like that is what you can kind of keep in mind. overreaching, I would argue, good, as long as you're doing it a little bit. Just a little bit, just enough to see changes in adaptation, progress. Overtraining, bad. That's what you want to avoid across large amounts of time.
Yeah, yeah.
How do you recover from them and prevent them in the future? Josh, you kind of detailed that, how to recover from them and prevent them in the future. Just got to be aware. You got to be aware of all those things and make sure that you're programming accordingly, and your coach is, very understanding of how you're feeling and what you need in your program regarding your sleeping, your eating, your movement, and your stress management.
I do want to, I don't know if you were going to ask this question, but I saw that Coach Ed had kind of brought up the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system.
Mm-hmm.
And I do want to kind of touch on this because I do think that it has the potential to paint a really good picture on what a gigantic role the nervous system plays just in your day-to-day function, and then tie that back into what we were talking about with regards to exercise. So just to kind of recap, we said that the nervous system is comprised of two branches. You've got your central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. Central nervous system is kind of the governor of the whole thing. You've got your brain and spinal cord. The peripheral nervous system, you've got two different branches off of that. You've got your autonomic nervous system and then your somatic nervous system. We're not going to cover that one. We're going to cover the autonomic nervous system, which has two branches off of that, which is the parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system.
You're taking me back to A&P class.
Exactly. So the a really good way to understand the sympathetic nervous system that I remember is the sympathetic nervous system is your body's feeling sorry for you. So it's going to help you out in a stressful situation. So you get spooked or you're going down a dark alley and you need to have all your senses about you. Your body feels sorry, wants to help you out. So it's going to turn on the fight or flight system. So I know it would just be as simple to say sympathetic is fight or flight, parasympathetic is rest and digest. But for me, I always would get those two confused. So sympathy, feel sorry, your body's going to help you. It turns on fight or flight. So that is pupils dilate, all of the bowel function, digestion, and everything shuts down. It's basically, what do you need to either fight in that moment for your survival? Like, you need to have your wits about you, your hearing gets turned up, your smell, all that kind of stuff. Or to just take off and run. So what needs to happen within that? Parasympathetic nervous system is the counterbalance to that. That is when you are resting and digesting. And essentially, it is the exact, it performs the opposite functions of what the sympathetic nervous system. So pupils constrict, digestion happens, heart rate comes down, you know, blood and lymph are moved around to all of the organs, not just the ones that need to be innervated in the moment that you need to fight or flight, fight or run away from something. So that is what is going on with the parasympathetic nervous system. Now, in modern society, what we have figured out and what we've discovered and we see play out on a daily basis is we really don't have the stresses of what our ancestors had, you know, millennia ago, where walking out of your cave, you might be faced with a lion, a tiger, or a bear.
Oh my.
Oh my. I'm glad you were ready for that.
Oh my.
So that is what is going on. So these days, the stresses that we feel, and people have kind of hashtagged it like first world problems, somebody, God rest their soul, while I was in my car,
mm-hmm.
that has a full tank of gas, cold AC, and heated seats, dared to cut me off.
Scumbag.
And my blood pressure goes through the roof.
Did they use their signal?
They didn't even use sons of
guns.
People.
Yes.
Sons of guns.
Oh, man.
And and I say this because I am that person, and I have been. I'm trying not to be whenever I drive, but that is like sometimes where my greatest, and it's just ridiculous. And we're saying it with hyperbole, but that is actually the reality. Like, the fact that road rage exists tells you everything that you need to know.
Yeah.
Okay? But, so, the reason I say that is your body doesn't understand that when you're getting pissed off at the guy that cut you off at the red light without using his blinker is not the same thing as a tiger, because you are, what's the word I'm looking for? That you are reacting to it in the same way that your body's stress response is always, always, always turned up.
Stress is stress is stress.
Exactly. And so, why that matters is that you're never giving your body the ability to have the parasympathetic nervous system balance it out. So, I'm going to kind of tie this back around to our sleep, eat, move, manage, our SIM principle. A lot of times, and I know that people can get frustrated when they hear me say this, but instead of me giving you macros or a meal plan or telling you this food or that food to eat, I'm going to say, how about you sit down with no technology, with your significant other, chew your food 30 times before you swallow it, and by the way, get some vitamin D. Because I know it sounds like, oh, well, what's that going to do? I'm not watching my macros, or, you know, don't you want to tell me that I should have this food or that food? No, because it doesn't actually matter. You can have the perfect macro plan with the most wholesome, amazing of foods. But if you are in this heightened state of fight or flight, your sympathetic nervous system is turned up to a 12 out of 10, your body's not in a rest and digest state.
Mm-hmm.
So food is information. But if the information can't get taken in because it can't rest and digest, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. So, what can you take away from it? Well, number one, maybe adopt some of those principles. Sit down, chew your food, relax, stay away from the technology, manage your stress in whatever ways you need to do it, not from an avoidance tactic. But then also from a movement perspective, and I think this is what Coach Ed was talking about, but if the movements or the exercises or the programming that you're doing have you in that high-stress, fight-or-flight response state, then you're never going to actually adapt, recover, and grow from it.
Well, so sympathetic, just to recap, your body's feeling sorry for you. So it's gonna turn on all the mechanisms that are going to help you fight or flight from the stressor, the threat that it's facing. Parasympathetic is the opposite. It's gonna help you rest and digest. This is the one that's predominantly on when there is no stressor. Think when you're sleeping, that's all parasympathetic activation.
Yep.
How should one balance both ends of these systems? When it comes to, I'm just asking because this is an Ed's comment. When it, you know, as it relates to exercise. So, like you said, if you're always stressing, you're never going to adapt.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Does there need to be some stress for you to adapt? Does there need to be that for you to be able to overreach and?
How do you balance those out? Well, the first thing is you need to be aware of what your stressors are in your life. And you can't, because I've played this game and I was actually lying to myself for a long time, you can't say that, oh, I'm not stressed. No, you are. You're just not recognizing it as stress.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So number one, you need to be aware of what are the stressors in your life. And then you need to start taking stock of when are you actually giving your parasympathetic nervous system time to work. And so if you're not sitting down to eat, preferably with others, because there is a whole communal aspect that goes into food and eating, you know, with your family and friends. And it also promotes the putting away of phones and technology. But if you're not sitting down and taking at least 15 to 30 uninterrupted minutes to eat your meal chewing your food 30 times, not having technology with you. That means no TV, no podcast, no nothing, just being, resting, allowing the body to digest, that you are out of balance. And I think I can speak for everybody, myself included, that you are overdoing it on the sympathetic nervous system. And you don't get ulcers.
Great book. Very academic if you're
in
that sort of thing.
Yeah. So how do you balance it out? It's just that. And then from a health and fitness coaching standpoint is talk to your coach, because again, generalizations are not going to work. Everybody is different. And how you respond to a stressor, the same stressor outwardly, is going to be different than how I respond to it. And so if somebody is just saying, hey, do this for this thing, when this stressor pops up, it's not going to work for the two people the same.
Right.
So that's why we believe in the individualization of things like that. I know that's such an it depends answer, but it does. But I will say the generalization that I think I can count on one hand the number of people that I know that I would say have that kind of balance where they are allowing the parasympathetic to balance out the sympathetic nervous system from a sleep, eat, move, and manage standpoint.
Meaning that everybody is letting the sympathetic nervous system...
Yeah, you're just in this chronic state of stress response over and over and over.
Scary, man.
Yep.
Scary.
It is. That's it. That's all I got today.
That's it? That's it. We covered so much, man. Look at the sheet. Look at the sheet of chapter markers.
Yes. Look at all the learning people are going to get today.
Stress. A lot of science-y stuff that we covered today. Let's see what your mom said. She commented 1 minute ago, you can feel the difference if you eat on the run or shovel the food in a hurry or try and eat in a calm setting, chew your food and taste it and enjoy it. Definitely improves digestion. Meals should be quick. She said you still have a rest and digest point. And even taking 20 to 30 minutes to read helps more than napping if you can't slow down and take a nap.
Ooh, there you go.
That's a good point. I like reading.
All right. Well, that's all I got for today.
Yeah, thank you to everybody that was part of the discussion on the live feed. Thank you for tuning in to the live feed. See, we had 4 viewers at the end there. That's pretty darn good.
Yes.
Not as high as 8, I think we got that one time, but hey, I'll take 4. So, thank you for listening to this podcast. Thank you, Josh. I think that's all I got. Leave a 5-star written review on iTunes. If you're listening on SoundCloud,